Hey, hello everybody, how are you doing this morning? That's morning for me. Excellent. Right, so this is a weird talk that I have been putting together for several weeks and actually just put the slides this morning, so there's a lot of technical difficulties, but don't worry about that. And what I'm looking to do is to attempt to kind of capture the spirit of DBIC as far as I understand it, of what is actually the important part. There have been multiple ways to look at DBIC and to try to showcase it from this side or from this side. There are several trainings. We had the training yesterday, which was some people say, okay, I wasn't very happy to improve a lot of stuff. But I want to try to show you something mind-blowingly complicated and also some very simple stuff at the same time to basically kind of give you the contrast of what the framework actually can do. So what is DBIC? As I said, there are multiple ways to look at it. This is kind of like the official tagline. That's a framework that is designed to work with two-dimensional flat result sets, more or less Excel spreadsheets, or what you get from a database when you issue a query. It is rooted a lot, actually, not somewhat, it's a lot in the SQL and DBI paradigm, mostly because nobody came forward with a reasonable way to plug different data sources that are not SQL into DBIC. So, for example, there was somebody talking about trying to do LDAP. This didn't go anywhere. Somebody really wants to do DBIX class Mongo. I'm kind of glad this didn't go anywhere. But currently, yes, currently we pretty much only talk to DBI. There's an actual subclass. DBIX class storage is the main class. DBIX class storage DBI is a subclass that talks to DBI. And we don't have any other DBIX class storage subclasses currently. So if somebody comes up with a cool idea of how to do things, hit me up. And there are several individual layers in the library itself which are mostly independent and disconnected. Even more on the official way to look at stuff is that we have four layers within DBIC, this disconnected paradigms, which are one is a metadata storage, which is basically the data store, data source and relationship model abstraction framework. So you basically have a result source instance for every result source that you have in your database and you want DBIC to talk to. So those would be tables, views, stored procedures, sometimes just a piece of SQL called virtual views and so on. The point is that in this first stage, all you say is you statically at startup, more or less, define this source. It's a table named search, has columns search, each column has attributes like date time is nullable, there is data type, and so on and so forth. This can be done by hand, this can be done in schema loader, doesn't matter. The other part is the query definition and the manipulation framework, which is basically the result set classes and subclasses, which more or less are a query plan. Right? Anytime that you are about to talk to something, either retrieve results or add new results, you first set up something that represents the current state, so to speak, of a particular source. And you go from there. Then we have, once we get something from the database, once our query plan is executed, we need to parse it somehow to present it to you, right? You cannot just give you a raw cursor. The default one is the DBIX class row instances that are basically simple hashes with accessors and some extra methods like insert, delete, update, and so on and so forth. And you can have additional result classes which I'll show after to further down. And we have the storage IO abstraction layer, which basically is the part of DBIC that talks to your database. And you normally don't really worry about that, but it is something that covers for about 10,000 lines of code to work with different quirks and differences of the different engines that you're going to load. So basically, you don't need to know what the limit dialect is for your particular database. You don't need to know whether it supports insert determining. You don't need to know how to correctly insert blob data and so on and so forth. So basically, all of this is taken care of behind the scenes for you. So that's, you know, kind of like the hybrid tower overview of what DBIC is. And the main overriding point is that anytime you pass from one to the other, as a user, you retain complete control at every boundary. So you define some stuff here, then you might not want to use the result set abstract, you want to use something else, you can plug it in if you observe some pretty basic API requirements that you have. You can put pretty much anything you want in here, and you can write your own search abstraction there if you want. And this is how it looks in code, pretty much the same thing. Almost every application or every subroutine that has to do with DBIC starts with this. You basically get an instance of your schema class, and your schema class is already predefined. It has the result sources that it knows about, and so on and so forth. And then on this schema instance, you can get the result source instance for a particular result source. You can get the result set, by calling schema result set, the name of the source that you registered. And you can get back raw objects, which are basically representations of what the database just did. Again, pretty basic stuff. But if you take all this away, and you kind of ask the question, like, why would you use DBIC in the project in the first place? DBIC is massive more than this. And if you start thinking about it a little bit more than that, you're basically going into, you're kind of starting to get in a logical loop, because you'll start doing a lot of stuff in DBIC for DBIC's sake. Okay? You have to remember that after all, you're using this library only to talk to a data store in a way that is simpler and is allowing you to do more complex stuff as code. That's it. It's very often that we get one of the most frequent questions we get on support by the channel or on the mailing list is I have this existing thing that I need to port to DBIC. How do I do that? You don't. You don't need to. If it's something that's working and this code that already is probably covered by tests, it's also battle tested, so on and so forth. If a part of your project uses DBIC, you don't have to convert everything to DBIC. There's no point in that. You can share your database handles just fine, and you can, and that's pretty much your only point where things kind of meet in the middle. Your old code will work fine, the DBIC code will work fine as well. I'll show you how to combine them in terms of transactions and other stuff that we'll serve the time. Now, the issue with DBIC is also because it's factored out somewhat correctly, it's not perfect, there are quirks, but it's factored out more correctly than most frameworks. It also allows you, in a more convenient way, to organize your own business project. And this is arguably the more conventional reason why people choose to switch to DBIC, even though for me personally, this is not really a big selling point, because I mean, if you need help with organizing your stuff, maybe it shouldn't be a problem in the first place, right? I mean, this is basic part of the thing. But anyway, let's focus a little bit on the stateful query generator. Now, why do I say stateful query generator? For example, we have SQL abstract, which is a completely stateless query generator. Like, if we just do a little demonstration, we can do, I don't know. this is completely stateless query language. So we essentially an object, we don't say anything, we just give it a full bar argument, and that's it. It doesn't need to know what your table looks like, it doesn't need to know anything about this. But this is not very useful because then you need to keep the entire schema in your head, you need to know what your selectors are, you need to know what your columns are, you need to know your table names, your aliases, and so on and so forth. And you need to know what your database engine understands. So that's what we can say to query generator. And I want to show you a pretty complex example of how you could push this to the limit of pretty much what you can do in terms of generating queries by going through a problem that is not very often encountered, but sometimes is. Imagine you have a tree of objects. Basically, you have a database that looks like this. So you have artists who have CDs, who have tracks, and the track, if it's very good hit, it can spawn a single CD, which is also a CD. It just belongs to a particular tag because it's a single. Okay. So, pretty basic stuff. I mean, the columns are self-explanatory, that's not the important part. The important part is that we have a particular set of relationships. And imagine that all of those tables had a column called last modified. And imagine that you wanted to traverse this entire hierarchy of objects and get all the CDs for which any of the related things have a modified date more recently than some. Does this kind of make sense? Okay, so for example, you need to show in some kind of threaded forum which ones were unread since date, such and such, you would use the same thing. Now, because I wanted to make this code actually runnable, everything you see here, you will be able to run against the DBIC test database directly. I'm not going to look for a date, because every single table has a primary key, which is an auto-increment integer. I want to look for CDs, any related objects which have an ID larger than 60. So that's our problem that we're going to solve. So we start with input of boilerplate, which we're going to abstract away in all other slides. There is nothing here. So basically, we have our strictures, we have our super data number, we have the inclusion of our DBIC test database, and we add a helper that will allow us to generate some of the SQL with less type. But you could do without this by writing everything on hand. For the sake of brevity, we're going to use it here, and at the end, we end up with a schema instance out of the actual DBIC test schema which you run every time you install the case. So, this stuff is boilerplate, so it will just be abstracted from this. And we have an S, $S, as we saw. So, we're looking for anybody who is related to CD with an ID higher than 16, so we need to start from CD. So, our start result set will be all CDs we currently have to deal with. And the chain that we're going to interrogate, we're going to go to artists, so from the CDs we're going to go up. And then we're going to go down to tracks, right? From CDs we go to tracks. And then from tracks we're going to go to CD single, so we're going to throw the relationship back if the track has any single CDs. And then from this single we're going to get the tracks as well, because the single CD doesn't only have one track, it has several as well, right? So this is our chain that we're going to interrogate. We can see what's in the test database just by running this. So we run the number, we take the starter S, which is the CD. We get the entire chain. With DBIC, don't make objects for us, but make everything into a hash. This is an alternative data that comes out of DBIC. And the value of this thing is a nested tree of caches, which if we actually run this thing and we grab out the primary keys, those are all the primary keys that exist in the database as it comes from the tarball policy. So this stuff will match. So we need to find which CD has these objects attached to. Right, so how do we do that? We could, of course, iterate through the entire tree and everything, you know, basically keep drilling down through this chain. But this is extremely time consuming, and the bigger your database is, the more queries you're going to issue, right? So that's not feasible. So we're going to determine this in a single query. Just single query, no emacs, no ticks, works on SQLite and on any other database you can think of. And relatively performantly, and the query is hideous, but the code you generated isn't. So let's see how we get that. So we're back to this. Now, we have one result set, and to go further, we basically need to create result sets that represent the extra nodes in our, so to speak, object list. So we're going to make a small function called related sets. And related sets takes one result set and returns the immediate all the related sets for this result set going down the chain we gave it. So what are we doing here? Those are basically just ways to invoke the same function recursively in a case this array. So we'll call it for arrays, drill down one branch, we'll call it for the other branch, drill down. So that's interesting here. And in case the thing is not a hash, so it's when we enter our chain, we're just going to give it an empty hash to, you know, to simplify the rest. The interesting thing is here. So we have a hash of several directions that we're taking. Here we have only one. So we have the hash of tracks and some other stuff. So what we do is we take the result set from which we started, which in our case will be CD. We ask for a related result set with this name, so tracks in our case. We put it into sets. And then we drill down again of this last result set that we just made. We keep going down the chain and we keep accumulating things in sets. And once we run this thing recursively through this chain, we can then go ahead and take all the return sets here on the second line. Add an additional selector to them. So basically, a result set by default gives you everything from a source. We're going to get only a particular count, which will be the primary count for this very result set. And then we're going to render it as SQL, just to see what this set would represent if it is run. So far, so good, right? Not terribly complicated. So, well, no, this is not terribly complicated. It will get a little bit worse. So we have this. The scope of this is this. So the first related set is the artist, right? The first thing that we had in the chain was artist. So we'll get the primary key of artist when we go from CDs, and then we're going to join to artists with the correct condition. The second one is tracks, again, so the same level. It's the same simple thing. Now, after that, we're going from tracks, we're going to level deeper. So we have, we went back to CDs with different areas. So we start from CD, we join tracks, we join CD single. And then we get the tracks of the single CD of the track of the CDs. We go. Now, this is not pre-canned queries or anything like this. This indeed was generated from here. There is no other code inside the world. Now, this alone is something interesting. Basically, each of those will just give you all the data there is. We're going to switch things a little bit. So this is what we had originally, and we're going to add a mark for when we run this when we run the subroutine. We're going to mark when we just started, when we did the first social layer. And then when we drill down, we'll drill down. So we're going to change this. We're going to add an extra argument whether we went past level 1 or not. And then on the bottom, depending whether we are past level 1 or not, we're either going to drill down into a further down chain. So we're going to preserve this stuff. But when we're here, instead of doing a simple chaining, we are going to use the correlate helper that we added in the workflow. Now, what correlate helper does is it, instead of doing simple joins, it creates a proto query that would relate to every single row in the main source that we started using on CD. So basically, think of it as for every single CD individual row, it will do this entire work. So basically, it will go and get all the related things that relate to this particular CD. And then go on the next one, the next one, on the next one. So those are the only two things we change. We still go to the band. And if originally we had this, the result now is this. So what changed? The selections are the same. The fronts shifted one in. So originally we had, we always started from CD. Now the fronts are one level in. So here we had front CD join uplist. Now it will be from uplist. We had front CD join track. Now it is from track. Here we had front CD join track join CD single. Now it is from track join CD single, and so on. And instead, this original link, the CD to join and CD to join, we transfer it into a where condition that was at end. And that's why for every foreign key on the main table, we're going to get this entire query executed every time for every single row. Okay? So, again, we have this thing. We'll let it all it already works. We can leave only the data sets. We start from the chain. We start from the result set and we get the chain. We're going to move this on to that. So now we know that this thing gives us a bunch of result sets, which can be converted to a query, right? What we're going to do now is we're going to iterate to every single result set, add them to, sorry, one second, to make sure I don't confuse you any further. What we do is we make another collector for queries. And we go ahead and generate out of each fragment that we get here, we generate an actual exists subquery. Because remember, we will be looking for stuff where the result of this has a change date, or in our case, a primary key, more than 16. So we're going to select all the primary keys that relate to a particular CD from the single tracks. We're going to get all the primary keys from the singles that relate to a particular CD. We're going to get all the primary keys from tracks that relate to a particular CD. And we don't care what they are, we only care whether one exists or not. So our query looks like this. The actual query fragment exists. The result set that was generated, where the primary column is more than 16, and make a query about this. If we go ahead and now search from here using all these conditions, and we do a count, we're actually going to get our two, because we have two CDs, the cat tracks which the cat single tracks of the single CD of the track which has IDs 1 and 16. And we make an additional thing there to aid optimize it not very smart because we're not actually selecting anything, this is an exists pool. We're going to add a selector of one so the database can throw it with faster. So the optimizer is basically to discover. And the actual query to get this is that. Now, writing this by hand is not too bad. Modifying it 6 months later is horrible. So let's run through this real quick. So we're looking in cities where there are some results, but where the artist ID related to every particular CD is more than 16, or the track ID related to every CD is more than 16, or. Can you follow somewhat? Here and there. Okay. The important part is that to generate this thing, this is all our code that we use. Alright. Single query, very efficient on the optimizer, even MySQL and very large tables will do really well in terms of running this. And as far as the SQL goes, it's not great. As far as the actual code that happens here, you actually can reason about this thing. It's not trivial, but you will be able to follow this and as the coworker who wrote it, you will be able to make changes relatively safely because your aliases will be adjusted for you correctly, your conditions will be adjusted for you correctly. For example, here we set 16 only once, right? Whereas here it's all over the place, and our aliases are tracked correctly, and for example, the select one, if you forget about it, your DBA will not be happy, and things like that, right? So, that's as bad as it gets. Normally, it's not so bad. Yes, question.
Do you know if this SQL rules work with common table expressions?
Yes, because CTs are pretty much only a Postgres and Microsoft SQL Server, I never looked into how to do it because I needed to work on SQLite. Actually, SQLite did it to CTs relatively recently, about a year ago, but I haven't. Sorry. But I haven't gotten that far yet to see how this would be done. But yes, this can be done on CTs, definitely. But again, how many businesses still run on MySQL, even started recently? It's just. I guess it works somehow for some reason. For most people. To go on the other side, now this was query generation, right? To go on the other side of the of what DBIC is, it is the result parser. Now, this is what prefetch actually looks like. Normally you just write prefetch, citizen, chat, and nothing else. But this is the rollout form. Now, why am I showing you the rollout form? Because what you're actually doing is you have a source, you join some stuff, and then you say in a very concise way which columns you want to go where. So what you're going to get here is you're going to get your main artist object, which will get all the columns defined on this source. And then you say, get me a little bit more columns. Go ahead and get me the ID and the artist ID of every CD and put them into a CD object hanging off the main one into column destination's name like this, so same name. And here what we do is go ahead, get the genre ID and hang it off of the CD's object then make the genre object, and then put it into the ID slot. And here, if you notice, we specified only two columns, even though our CDs had many more. So we can tell easily what we want to fetch out of the database and where to put it. So that's pretty cool. But what about this? Here we're saying get stuff over here, and in addition, select stuff not from here, but directly from here, and hang it off the curved objects, and it still does it. How does it do it? Because it knows that those pairs here are identifying a specific CD, even though we didn't fetch any from the CDs. And anytime you do this, you basically go to the result set. This one's supposed to be here. So we go back to the result set, we get our results, we call CDs on it, and then we call next, and we get the counts. There will be nothing because we didn't put anything in the CD object. But the object is there because we had to hang this object off of that, right? And DBIC will figure out for you, for each pair of genre ID and genre CD ID, it will make a different cache, which will be empty, but it will know where to hang what. And the actual data that you get out of this will be the exact representation of what is in your data. And then, to think about that, I think that's pretty cool. And yes, if you actually call genre on the same empty CD, you will actually get the object that you were looking for. Now, additionally, I often show this as columns. There's another way to write it, which is like this. So it's actually the same way. We take all this stuff and put in a plus select, and we take all this stuff and put in a plus s. Normally, you write it like this because then it's clear what goes where. Right? It's much easier to read and easier to modify. The reason sometimes you write things like that is because you might want to do this. You might want to take some literal, which means I know what I'm doing, just you know, execute this to the database. Some crazy SQL, whatever it is, of course, we'll have some bind values, so we'll bind the crazy together. And it can still tell DBIC, because we knew what we're doing, we know that this particular SQL fragment returns four selections. We still route them where we want them to go. And this will also work just fine. Now, as I mentioned earlier, transactions and the database handling in general is the only thing that kind of works as a medium point between your old code and your new code that often you wrote using DBIC. Now, how do transactions work in DBIC in general? They look like that, which is pretty basic. With the addition that if you start doing stuff here and the first time that you try to write to the database in this transaction, the database handle was disconnected for some reason. In MySQL, you often have variable timeouts, and you get the message of server is going to wait, isn't that? Yes. Server is going to wait, isn't that? This entire stuff will be rerun for you automatically while you open the connection and open the transaction. Except when you have stuff like this. Now, this looks weird, right? You start a transaction, do more stuff, and then you start another transaction and do even more stuff. The reason this works is that DBIC internally, in general, in database engines, you cannot have multiple transactions that nest. You can have save points, and some engines even do nest transactions in a very weird way, but in general, the outer transaction is the one that wins. Well, DBIC simply replicates that. So you start here, transaction is open, you do some stuff, then the request of DBIC to make a transaction. Again, it looks in the internal counter, sees the transaction is already open, and it will not do anything. It will just increase the counter here, decrease the counter here, and then when we go to the end of this, it will go ahead and commit everything, and the whole thing will automatically be in your database. Now here, it's not very interesting, but you have to realize that this two stuff might be calling something else, which itself might be opening the transaction. So you can have complex business logic that keeps separate pieces of your stuff atomic by rapid transactions around them. But if you wrap a transaction around the whole thing, everything will stack forward state without any problem. Another way to do things, you don't want to open a transaction unless you have to. So you do some stuff, and this stuff here will normally be atomic, it's just single update and nothing else. So you don't need transaction for it, you don't want to, you know, to have database do more work. But maybe because of some other reason, you need to do some other stuff here that needs to be atomic with this stuff. Well, what do? You just declare an empty variable, you put a scope graph in this variable if you did it, which will start a transaction, and then if we did have a card in first place, then we'll commit it, and everything will be committed at this point, after the begin at this point. Or none of this will happen at all if this condition is satisfied.
The next thing was
yes.
The same with the garden.
Sorry?
With the garden, the next thing of the transactions works the same.
What do you mean the next thing?
Nested transactions.
Oh, yeah, yes, of course. Of course, they all nest, they all share the same common. Yes, this works just fine. In two pre-flight stuff and regular stuff, you can have a TXM tool on your own, and inside the TXM tool, you can have another scope graph, and it will work together. So, to wrap up, just a stateful query generator and stateful result parser. And one more minute to say a few words about plain Perl with others. I mentioned about your old project and your new, you know, code that you wrote in DBIC, how to put them together. Normally, in all manuals, you see this. You basically connect DBIC to your database via your JSON. However, you can actually do this. And you can reuse your existing code's database handle in DBIC as well. And that will work correctly, including transaction states. So, for example, when you do this, and your factory already gives you an open transaction, DBIC will know this and will work as if this entire thing is wrapped in another outer scope. So this TXM tool will basically be a null. It will just increase the counter, and not do anything. It's up to you or your DBH factory to commit your transaction that way. Or on the other side, when you have a result object, normally it is placed into the default class of DBIC, or you can do hashes, just like I showed earlier in the example. But really, what you can do is you can provide something else which only has to give DBIC one method called inflate result. What it returns is absolutely random. It can be a hash, it can be a DBIC object, it can be an object that is expected directly by your own legacy application, it can be an interchange schema, something, you know, an interchange file model object and so on and so forth. And all of this will work. So you can use DBIC just for the query generation. As far as the results go, you clean DBIC data out of your way and you just use it. And that's it. Do we have time for questions? Any questions?